I'm Megan Keith. Welcome to the History of Music, an introduction to the Western classical music tradition. Part 5 of our series, Early Romanticism, brings us into the early 1800s, a time when artists were deeply affected by the ideas that had led to revolutions in France and North America. Painters, musicians, and writers passionately believed in the concept of individual rights and began to express their innermost feelings and give free rein to their imaginations. It was Beethoven, with his Third Symphony, who led the artistic world into the Romantic era. Beethoven was inspired by the spirit of the times, and he worked to unify his symphonic movements around particular themes. We can hear this in his famous Fifth Symphony. The entire work is tied together with a simple four-note motif built into each movement. Beethoven was a master of many musical forms, but he is especially remembered for his powerful style, including his aggressive use of both dissonant and consonant harmonies. Inspired by Beethoven's work, many other composers of the Romantic period showcased spontaneity and imagination in their music. While classical artists relied on form and structure, the Romantic musicians gave priority to emotional expression. Franz Schubert, Hector Berlioz, Franz Liszt, Frédéric Chopin, and Robert Schumann. We will learn about all of these leading composers of the Romantic era. Finally, we will travel to Italy, where opera remained the most popular musical form. It's here that composer Giuseppe Verdi helped opera transcend the Baroque style into the powerful emotion of Romanticism.
In the 1790s, Ludwig van Beethoven had studied with Haydn, and his first two symphonies had followed the formats developed by Haydn and Mozart. In 1804, Beethoven completed a third symphony, which he subtitled Heroic. While it was based on the same forms, it was a work of unprecedented expressive power. Beethoven reached maturity during the turbulent years of the French Revolution, and he was in spirit a young man of his times. Heroism, struggle, fate, victory. These were concepts that inspired him, and he tried to convey them in his music. In his Heroic Symphony, Beethoven built a strong musical structure, much longer than previous symphonies, but with each part contributing to an overall unity. A symphony was no longer simply a group of four unrelated movements. Ever since it was introduced in 1808, his Fifth Symphony has suggested to audiences a great victory won after intense struggle. The entire work is unified by a simple four-note motif that is integrated into each movement. Composing like this was slow and painstaking, requiring continual experimentation and revision. But Beethoven was not trying simply to please a patron. He was trying to reach all humanity, present and future. The music audience was growing in the early 1800s, as the middle class began to have time and money to support the arts. Still, a composer could not survive without help from patrons. Beethoven did not completely reject help from the wealthy, but he accepted it only on his own terms, demanding to be treated not as a servant, but as an artist accountable to himself. Beethoven was regarded as the foremost composer of his time. He excelled in all the standard forms, chamber music, religious choral works, and even opera. But some of his music bewildered and challenged his listeners, especially his use of dissonance.
harmony is the sound of several notes played at once, especially in homophonic music. Along with many other factors, harmony affects the strength of tonality. Harmony includes sound combinations that range from consonant to dissonant. Consonant harmony tends to sound smooth, clear, and generally more relaxed. Dissonant harmony tends to sound more agitated, restless, and disturbed. While both consonants and dissonance had been a feature of music for centuries, Beethoven used dissonance much more aggressively than had any of his predecessors.
During the early 1800s, the piano was undergoing many changes in design and construction, giving it a stronger, more powerful voice with greater expressive possibilities, which Beethoven explored in his later sonatas. The mighty sounds he called forth became the measure of the piano's power for generations. Beethoven's own life was a struggle. He endured a handicap especially painful to a musician. At age 28, he began to lose his hearing. By age 50, he was totally deaf. During his later years, the composer turned inward, producing music that often gives the impression of deep thought, of groping with cosmic ideas. Even today, this music sounds strange to many listeners. One of his late works remains among his most popular. His Ninth Symphony, with its profound statement of faith in universal brotherhood, is celebrated for its innovative use of a chorus in the finale, the singing of Friedrich Schiller's Ode to Joy. The intensity of his music, his pride in himself as an artist, and his merging of symphonic music, choral singing, and poetry made Beethoven a hero to a group of young composers who represented a new spirit in the arts called Romanticism. The Romantic movement brought together musicians, writers, and painters whose personal lives were often as unconventional as their art. This painting portrays a group of these young artists symbolically gathered beneath a bust of Beethoven.
As with the word classical, the word romantic has many meanings. As used to describe movements in the arts, however, the two words are almost opposites. If the classicists valued clarity, restraint, order, and rational organization, the romantics valued spontaneity, passion, and imagination. Where the classical artist gave priority to overall form and structure, the romantic artist gave priority to emotional expression and, in music, to such matters of sensation as tone color and melody. The classicist saw himself as a humble artisan, striving for the highest standards of workmanship, while the romantic saw himself as a lonely prophet, struggling to express a message from within.
One of the young romantics was Franz Peter Schubert, who was born in this suburb of Vienna a few years after Beethoven arrived in the city. Attracted to the idea of combining music and poetry as Beethoven had done, Schubert, while still a teenager, began setting poems to music.
Oh,
Schubert wrote some 600 Lieder, the German word for songs, sometimes composing several in one day and often using the same poem over and over. Shy and indifferent to material success, Schubert drew little public attention. Though he died at age 31, he composed an enormous quantity of music, but hardly any of it had been heard, except by his enthusiastic circle of friends. One of his 9 symphonies, called the Unfinished Symphony because it has only 2 movements, was not performed until nearly 40 years after his death. Today, it is his most famous work. Although it is based on standard sonata allegro form, it differs from the classical style in several ways. It emphasizes mood and melody. Creates variety in tone color by featuring instruments other than the strings. Many young composers of the early 1800s were moving in similar directions. Some went further than Schubert, using the symphonic form to tell a story. Hector Berlioz, a French composer just a few years younger than Schubert, fell deeply in love with an actress he had seen on stage but had never met. He decided to write a symphony as part of his effort to impress her. Called Fantastic Symphony, it depicts the drug-induced fantasy of a sensitive young musician tortured by love. Berlioz represents his beloved by a particular theme, called an idée fixe, which recurs in each movement. At the end, the musician is beheaded, and a grotesque funeral follows in which his soul is mocked by his beloved, now transformed into a witch. To portray his extravagant story, Berlioz called for an enlarged orchestra, including such instruments as the English horn and the harp, instruments not usually used in symphonies. The result is a rich array of subtle tone colors and some stunning effects. Franz Liszt, a 19-year-old pianist and composer from Hungary, was on tour in Paris and attended the first performance of Berlioz's unusual work. Liszt was so impressed that he arranged the Fantastic Symphony for piano and included it in his recitals all over Europe. As a composer, however, Liszt was even more radical than Berlioz. While Berlioz's work aims to tell a story, it otherwise follows classic symphonic form. But Liszt tried to abandon classical forms altogether, developing the symphonic poem, an orchestral piece meant to depict a series of moods or tell a story, often called program music. His symphonic poems were held together by themes, each representing an element of the story, the way Berlioz used the idée fixe to represent his beloved. The musical devices Liszt used to suggest longing, restlessness, mystery, and unfulfilled love greatly reduced the sense of tonal stability. These devices are called chromatic, related to color, because they enrich or color the tonal structure. Liszt's symphonic poems often seem like successions of colorful episodes that begin and end at whim, without a preconceived formal plan. But as innovative as he was as a composer, Liszt won his greatest fame as a pianist. His reputation was established in Vienna, where at age 10 he performed for Beethoven and met Schubert. This was the beginning of the age of the virtuoso, a solo performer who exerted an almost magical spell over audiences through a combination of personal magnetism and astonishing musical skill. Niccolò Paganini was the first great romantic virtuoso. His phenomenal wizardry on the violin, combined with his exotic appearance, prompted rumors that he was possessed by the devil. Touring throughout Europe, Paganini won great wealth and fame. Young Liszt sought to capture the public's fancy in a similar manner. His talent was supported by continuing improvements in the construction of the piano, which could now produce a range of expression, from delicately whispered melodies to thundering cascades of sound. Liszt became a glamorous personality, and frequently the butt of cartoonists and reporters during his long years of triumphant concert tours. His love affairs with various countesses and princesses were widely publicized. Throughout his long life, Liszt used his wealth and power to help spread the names and work of other gifted composers of the time, most of whom were his friends. He even championed a potential rival, Frédéric Chopin. A pianist about the same age as Liszt, who in his native Poland had been hailed as another Mozart. But the frail Chopin lacked the physical stamina for the heroic role of a virtuoso. He preferred to play for small groups in intimate settings, suitable to his delicate, dreamy style. Chopin's compositions were tailored to his own strengths as a pianist, evoking wistful moods through his own brand of chromatic harmony. Chopin's playing style was so admired that even his hands were portrayed as objects of art. He was especially highly regarded in Paris, where he came to perform his own compositions. His short pieces for piano solo, often called character pieces because they centered on a single mood, harked back to the Baroque idea of restricting a piece to one emotion. But musical language had changed so much over nearly two centuries that the effect was now very different. The character piece for the piano became a favorite of romantic composers and performers. Robert Schumann, a German composer born the same year as Chopin, was another master of the character piece. His dream of becoming a virtuoso ended when he injured his hand, but he wrote a great deal of music for the piano. His pieces were performed throughout Europe by his wife Clara, one of the most important musicians of the time. Settling in Leipzig, Robert Schumann founded and edited a journal of musical opinion and became a central figure in the Romantic movement, helping to promote such talented colleagues as Chopin and Schubert. But he had great difficulty establishing himself as a composer. Schumann's music embodied two characteristic romantic attitudes. One, sensitive and dreamy. The other impetuous and passionate. He even devised names for these two sides of his personality and sometimes signed his compositions with the one that applied.
In the 19th century, as in the century past, Vienna was the center of European musical activity, where the Austro-German school of composers, Haydn, Mozart, Beethoven, Schubert, Schumann, and others, dominated musical thinking. Paris was another center, attracting Liszt, Chopin, and others who made their reputations there. But in Italy, the center of musical life during the Baroque period, composers had isolated themselves from the European mainstream, concentrating almost exclusively on opera. The Italian people were intensely devoted to music, and the support they gave to composers was rewarded by a continual supply of works created to suit their tastes.
Opera was still viewed as a showcase for singers, as it was more than a century before, when the art of bel canto began. Appealing melodies were primary. Plot, costume, scenery, and instrumental accompaniment all were given relatively minor attention, until the arrival of Giuseppe Verdi. Verdi had an instinctive gift for conveying intense emotions through simple, direct music tailored expertly to the human voice. The son of a poor innkeeper from a small village, Verdi had little musical training and could barely play the piano. But he understood the tradition of Italian opera so deeply that he was able to expand it, creating powerful human dramas of lust, passion, and violence that captivated the Italian public. Italy's resistance to foreign musical influence was part of a political struggle against foreign domination. Verdi, an ardent nationalist, imbued his operas with patriotic fervor. The enthusiastic cry, "Viva Verdi!" became a political slogan, as well as a sign of appreciation, as huge numbers of people, rich and poor, flocked to his operas, many attending performances night after night. Otello is one of two operas based on Shakespeare's plays that Verdi created when he was in his 70s. Otello and Falstaff, with their dramatic coherence and advanced use of the orchestra, are widely considered to be his greatest accomplishments. Verdi, the most popular Italian composer of all time, lived into the beginning of the 20th century. He was buried on the grounds of a home he had established for aging musicians. As the coffin passed, the streets filled with people who spontaneously began to sing one of his most beloved melodies, Va Pensiero. Thank you.